Nobody likes bolts or fasteners coming loose, and Loctite as a product has long been the go-to for threadlocking compounds. However, there's a lot that people generally don't know about how these compounds work, where they should be used, where they shouldn't be used, and how they actually function. We're here with Matt from Loctite to find out a little bit more and fill in some of those gaps in our knowledge. So for a start, Matt, it's not just one threadlocker that Loctite offer. You've got a range. So can you talk to us about the different threadlocking compounds that you offer?
Yeah, so we have multiple different compounds depending on what your application is, right? And whether it's going to be a serviceable part or whether it's going to be a permanent fixture, as well as a heat range. So we start with our purple threadlocker. That's going to be an adjustable, really small bolt, something that, you know, like a set screw or something on a throttle body that you need to have adjustment capabilities, but you don't want that to fall out.
So this threadlocker will do the job of stopping the bolt moving when we don't want it to, but you're still able to actually adjust that set screw without affecting or negatively impacting the threadlocker?
Correct. Yeah.
All right, stepping up from that, something that maybe doesn't need servicing, what are our next options?
Yeah, something that doesn't need servicing, right? If it's going to be something that may be in service somewhere down the line, we've got our blue thread locker, which is typically known as a medium strength, right? We still have the full strength of the Loctite thread locker, however, it becomes serviceable. So whenever we go to pull that apart, that material is actually going to powder, which allows you to get it off with hand tools as opposed to heating and using air tools to get that material off of there.
Okay, so just talking about servicing that, it is just a case of undoing the bolt as we normally would. The Loctite's not going to negatively impact the threads or cause any damage to the threads, right, either on the bolt or the component we're bolting into?
Yes.
Okay, so now we move into the more permanent form of Loctite. So I guess the hint in the name there is this is for something that we don't expect to ever have to pull apart in the future?
Correct, yeah. It's something that you don't expect to pull apart in the future, or sometimes we get into larger bolt applications, right? But we've got really applications all over. But with the red threadlocker, it's really known as that permanent fixture material, something that you're going to put on and you're never going to really need to get it back in. You're not going to need to service it or potentially need to go into a high temp range. We've got some high temp options within the red that allows you to get, you know, the usable service range a little bit higher depending on where the application is.
Okay, so I think probably what most people are doing, and I've probably been guilty of this in the past as well, is threadlock's a threadlocker, the red's the strongest, I'm just going to use this on every bolt that I need to install. So as you mentioned, it's a permanent installation, it's not really made for serviceability. What's going to happen when we try and remove a bolt or a fastener that's been installed using red threadlocker?
It's incredibly difficult. It does require localized heat in order to soften the material. The threadlocker actually turns into a thermoset plastic, so it's never going to go back to a liquid form. So whenever we heat it, it just softens it and allows you to get a little bit more leverage to it to be able to pull that out, but it becomes much more difficult. Typically what we see is people actually use red threadlocker more than blue, when it really should be the opposite way around. You actually should be using much more blue threadlocker than you would actually use red threadlocker.
Yeah, I think coming back to my previous point, most people are just grabbing the strongest and using it everywhere. In terms of that strength, I don't know if you can give us sort of an idea of what additional strength the red offers over a fastener that's been installed using blue.
Yeah, there's a little bit of strength difference, but in typical, it's pretty nominal, right? So for most applications, either one is actually going to work and do the job. 99% of the time, the blue will do the same job as the red. There is a little bit of a strength difference, but it's not enough, I think, in most cases, other than OE specification cases, right, where you're going to need specifically that more strength of a hold.
Now, another application where I know a lot of people mistakenly use threadlocking compounds is on hot components. One of the fasteners that's really hard to keep tight is anything around a turbocharger or exhaust manifold. And hopefully the eagle-eyed viewers might have already picked up on something you said about using heat to free up your red Loctite. So this is not a use application for a threadlocking compound, correct? Anything around a turbo?
No, it is not going to be. The typical anaerobic compounds in threadlockers are going to be good up to about 300 degrees.
We're talking Fahrenheit here, just for clarity.
Yeah. And then the red on our high temps, we can go up to about 450. And obviously, you're going to see higher temps than that. So in those applications, we would recommend either a mechanical fastener or a mechanical fastener along with a anti-seize compound. You should really use that anti-seize on there. It eliminates corrosion and galling inside of the threads, which is going to help to keep a stronger hold on that nut or bolt.
Yeah, it's a very different product, but seeing as you mentioned that, couldn't agree more. An anti-seize on anything that's seeing heat is going to save you a lifetime of frustration when it comes to removing those. Nothing worse than having threads pick up and galling and destroying the stud or the threaded hole that you're dealing with. let's talk a little bit about installation, because this is another area where I don't think people do their research. You've got information around how to use it, but I see people sort of lathering the entire length of the thread with Threadlock before installing it. Is that necessary? How many drops should we be using?
Yeah, no, definitely not necessary, right? So in essence, you really want to put the material, we say two free-flowing drops, right? So two drops out of the bottle. And you really only want to put the material where it's going to be surfaced with the threads. So any excess material that you put on there, it's not going to set up anyways. It's always going to stay liquid. And so really, you only need those two free-flowing drops where the threads are going to be engaged.
What about if we're dealing with a blind hole? Should we still be just installing those two drops onto the fastener that's suiting into that blind hole?
No, so that application is going to be a little bit different. So if you put the drops on the bolt, whenever you go to thread it into that blind hole, it actually will create pressure as you're screwing that in. It will actually force all the material back out of the hole before you've actually got it set all the way.
So we're achieving nothing.
Exactly, nothing. You're just a mess, really, at the end of the day. So really, in that application, you're going to want to put material on the inside of the hole. And you can put a little bit on the end of the bolt as well, but as you thread that in, it will create that pressure inside, and then it will actually inject the material back in between the threads. And then once you have that, you're going to have full coverage on that bolt.
All right, any other tips around general sort of installation process? Should we be cleaning the fasteners down? Does oil or lubricant matter? What do we need to know there?
Yeah, so we have a couple different materials that are what we call surface insensitive. And so in an application where a bolt may be a little bit dirty or a little bit greasy, that material will still work in those applications. But we do want to make sure that we're cleaning them. Another thing is a lot of the fasteners nowadays are coated parts. So those coated parts are not going to be active materials. So you have different metals. You've got active and you have inactive. So the way that a thread locker works is it works in the absence of air. So once it's in between the threads, but also in contact with active metals.
By active metals, I'm assuming here you're talking about ferrous versus the likes of stainless, for example, stainless being non-active, ferrous being active.
Exactly. Yeah. And so we do actually sell a primer as well that can be worked with all of our anaerobic compounds, but it's really great for the thread lockers. So in the instance where you have a coated part that's not going to be active, you can actually spray that on there. You can use it as a cleaner. You can also use it as a primer. So being a two-in-one product, it's great to have in every shop for all of your anaerobic uses.
Okay, I think that's filled in the gaps in my knowledge, and hopefully it's helped our viewers out there. If people want to find out more about the product or find a local dealer, how they best to do so?
Yeah, so you can call 1-800-LOCTITE. That's going to be our technical line, or you can go to our website and get in contact with one of our many people around the country.
Okay, thanks for your time, Matt.
Awesome, thank you so much.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.